in depth. From the direct source.
Let's get inside. Gain the insight with the insider.
สวัสดีครับ and welcome to another episode of The Insider. Reconciliation is a process. It is about building working relationship over time so that trust and confidence can be built and conflict diminishes in value. It is also about cooperation. As Thailand is in phase two of the roadmap, the country is set to embark on a sustainable path to peace and prosperity through a process of cooperation. What will this entail and how will this work? Moreover, how does this fit into the bigger picture of our national strategy? Our special guest this week previously came to talk to us about Thailand 4.0, the country's economic and industrial strategy. This week, he joined us to talk about how we need to approach reconciliation and how crucial this will be for Thailand's future. Today, we are very honored to have as our special guest once again, His Excellency Mr. Suvit Mayasinsi, Prime Minister Office Minister, who has recently been assigned by the Prime Minister to oversee our drive toward reconciliation. สวัสดีครับ Dr. Suvit ครับ Today we have a very good opportunity to meet Your Excellency once again a committee on national reform strategy and reconciliation. Why is this happening now and why do we need this body at this time?
Why we need national strategy? Because we are talking about how to pursue to the security, the prosperity and the sustainability. We have to make it come true within the next 20 years. This is very important for us. But we cannot do it without reform. So this is the first element is about our goals. The second element is about the means to achieve the goal. One of the most important thing is that our country are still not in the normal condition. We still need a kind of reconciliation. This why reconciliation is a very important. It's a necessary condition to make this dream come true. General Prayut Chan-o-cha put all things together. We also setting up a small team led by the NASDB, trying to prepare the first cut for the national strategy for the next 20 years. This I think we already done all this, but the problem is that this is the last year for this government. So I think what the Prime Minister would like to do is putting all together in order to, I think the merit of putting all together is about integration. Because when we talk about, for example, when we talk about the reconciliation, we cannot do it without some kind of reform initiative. For example, when we talk about the conflict among people, it's not just the political issue. But it involves any kind of fundamental problem like the fairness, like the inequality. And most of them are the structural problem that need reform, some reform initiatives to bombard in order to reduce the level of inequality among people, in order to make them access to the resources or what. So this is a kind of interaction among these three elements. And a part of, as I just told Khun Wirachon, that a part of the national strategy need reform. Otherwise, it's just a plan, right? So I think, as we know that almost all the country now passing to the sea of change into the 21st century, they need transformation. The same for Thailand. So this is why I think reform is just one part of it. And we after we reform, turn our economy or turn our society into the normal condition, then we'll have to further thinking about transform our country in order to be one of the first world country in the near future. So this kind of thing is a kind of interaction among these three strategic elements. And this is the reason why our Prime Minister said that, okay, why don't we put all things together, knitting it in order to gain some, you know, synergistic effect among these three elements.
You have mentioned the previous body or organization as the National Reform Council or the the Art Steering Committee. What is the difference between this committee and the others?
Actually, the first committee is like a reform initiative. They formulate the reform initiative and come up with 37 reform initiatives that I just mentioned. The second one, the steering one, is translate this or decode this initiative into action. But the problem is that most of them are on the supply side. The one who take a leading role in the reform actually is the government. Is at the government level as well as at the ministerial level. So this why this time we put this supply side. Most of them are from National Reform Steering Committee, and the demand side, most of them are assigned by the Prime Minister, delegate to the Deputy Prime Minister level. So, every Deputy Prime Minister, now we have six, right? Everyone is accountable for some kind of administrative reform. So we put them together under the committee, so-called the National Reform Preparation Committee. So this is what a part of the, as we just said, that the Committee on National Strategy, Reform and Reconciliation, right? We break that bit down into three or four subcommittees. And this is one of the integral part of that.
Presidency, as you play a vital role on these efforts, what would be your expectation or what is the tangible outcome that we will see?
The tangible outcome is we like to put all things together now, right? And maybe, setting up the foundation for the country before we hand over to the next government. What does it mean? It means that the country have to have a clear direction for the next 20 years in order to thrive in the 21st century. This is very important. So I think what we're trying to do is setting up the guideline for the country that what should be the right direction for us to what is the aim for the country to do that. But the second one is about, we have a lot of things to do to fix our country. We also have a lot of things to, to prepare or to invest for the future, of this country. But, for example, when we talk about reform initiative, now it's end up with more than 138 reform initiative. So we need to prioritize, and the Prime Minister always asks that what we should do within this year, the year that, still controlled by this government. So we should prioritize the most important and urgent reform initiative and trying to achieve it within this year. And at the same time, for some reform initiative, we should start doing it now, even though it will come up with the, with the result award within the next 2 or 3 years. So this is the second thing. But the most important thing is about, how can we ensure that, we are living our society, right? It's more peaceful. It's about, so this is a concern of this government. So this is why we still like to ensure that, to make our society more peaceful, we still need a kind of reconciliation. Which is more important is that, if we trying to do this thing, before May 22nd, 2 or 3 years ago, 2014, right? It's impossible, right? Because at that time, it's a kind of confrontation between, it's a kind of social division between two camps of people. But now, I think the condition already changed. I think within the new circumstances, for example, this government, I think we, in the perception of the people, we do a lot of things. And I think we show, particularly the Prime Minister showing, you know, his strategic intent that trying to not just only fixing our country or get out of the crisis, but also how can we, you know, aim for, you know, the transforming ourselves from the middle income country, right, to the first world country. So I think we earn credit, the government earned credit by its performance. Now, so it's the right time for us to setting up, you know, a kind of forum. But this time is not the forum just only for the existing political parties. No. Now, I think now we have to, we change two or three things. First, we are not focusing on a kind of, you know, trying to dissolve the conflict among two parties. Now we're trying to unlock any kind of obstacles that, you know, to make our, you know, to get out of the inequality trap, to get out of the, you know, to make our society more fairness, to achieve the fairness. So this kind of thing, I think, is very important. So the focus is not on the reconciliation among parties, political parties, but among people.
So we look beyond that.
We look beyond that, right. And we also look, we are not look backward, that, okay, what happened before May 22nd, but we are look forward to see how can we rebuild our nation, how can we, you know, think about the future of our country, of our new generation.
Which area of the reform that consider very important for the reconciliation?
One is about, you know, any kind of reform that regarding, you know, regarding the reduction of the inequality. The second one, right, the anti-corruption.
Yes.
But the third one is about administrative reform. So administrative function itself can be either the enabler or either the constraint, right? So, and we have a lot of problem within our administrative reform. So I think most of the initiative that offered by the National Reform Steering Committee or by the National Reform Council, you know, most of them, more than 25% of the initiative is focusing on a kind of these two things, administrative and regulatory reform.
The situation that Thailand is now facing may be same, may be different from the other country. Have we learned from the other, or have we taken the other country's, you know, experience as our lesson learned?
I think every country have their own problem. So we don't need to, you know, see any best practice or any lesson learned from others. I think we have our own, you know, a set of problems, as well as the, we also have our own set of path to development or path to, you know, path or any kind of set of opportunity for us.
Since you are here with us today, would you mind sharing with us or update us on Thailand 4.0?
Yes, Thailand 4.0 actually is a multidimensional model. Someone always perceive that, you know, Thailand 4.0 is about economics. It's focused more on economics dimension. It's about, you know, trying to transform our country to be more innovative, different economy. But this is just only a part of it. This is just a part of one of the dimension of Thailand 4.0. Thailand 4.0 in the social context, no one talk about that. But very important, if you heard from our Prime Minister, he always talk about, you know, left no one behind. Actually, this is one of the key principles of Thailand 4.0. And our Prime Minister always mentioned about, you know, Thai people 1.0, 2.0, 3.0, and 4.0. When we talk about Thai people 1.0, is people, is a suffered people. The 2.0 is from suffer to be more survive people. And the 3.0 is from survive to be more sufficient. Mm-hmm. And 4.0 is sustain, from, you know, suffer to survive, mm-hmm. and from survive to sufficient, and from sufficient to sustain. Mm-hmm. So this is the way that the Prime Minister think about Thailand 4.0 in terms of the social dimension. And this one is under the, I think, the principle of left no one behind. And this is very important thing. Because of what? Because when we think about this kind of thing, it automatically mean that, you know, we take the inclusiveness into account in the model of Thailand 4.0, right? And the second thing, our Prime Minister always talking about people. He always said that, you know, people is the key. It's impossible for Thailand 4.0 to achieve Thailand 4.0 without, you know, think about how can we improve the quality of our people. This is why we have a major shift. For example, in the context of, you know, global economy like this time, we have to make our people more competitive. But we also have to make our people, you know, make our people a mindful people, not just, you know, focusing on itself, but him or herself, or just focus. It's how can they, you know, go beyond the self-centric, think about themselves. And at the same time, we also have to turn our people from Thai Thai to be more global Thai, so that they can, you know, live and thrive in the global economy. At the same time, we're also trying to turn our people from analog Thai into the digital Thai. So I think Thailand 4.0 is not just only, you know, focusing on in terms of the quality of people, but also we like to change the context of our people so that he or she can live, you know, within the world, right? With happiness, with hope, happiness, and harmony.
People participation or comprehensive approach. Uh-huh. Would you be able to share with us?
Oh, that is very important things. I think what this government trying to do during this 2 or 3 years, we starting with what we call the economic democracy, democratization. So we are trying to uplift, right, or trying to get out of the poverty of the people. We're trying to let them access to the supply, to the resources, or what. So this, I think this is a starting point. This government trying to embed the democratization process into the country via economic. Mm-hmm. And from economic, now we turn it from economic democratization, now it is a time for us to think about political democratization. For example, when we talk about reform, we're talking about national strategy. Our Prime Minister always said that, you know, have to do three things first. When we talk about any kind of reform initiative, first ask about what people get from this, what is the benefit to our people. So this is the key questions before we trying to continue any kind of reform initiative. The second one is, do they understand what we are doing? This is the reason why, you know, it's very important thing that, you know, to now we're trying to do the public awareness about this committee, right? Yes. The national reform, national strategy and reconciliation. But we just awareness is not enough. We need to let our people understand what does it mean, but what does it mean for them, yes, about this reform, about this strategy, or about this reconciliation. And the third one is about how can they participate.
Exactly.
The important thing is not just only the content of the reform initiative, of the content of the national strategy, but it's about the process. Mm-hmm. How can we get people involved? Mm-hmm. I think this is the most important thing that we're trying to, is also a kind of democratization, because we're trying to make our people from passive citizen, mm-hmm, into the active citizen, and from active citizen into the engaged citizen. So this is, I think this is the integral part of this committee. So the committee itself is not just put all things together in terms of the content that we're trying to deliver to the next government, but it's a kind of democratization process by gradually transform our people from passive into the engaged citizens.
Anything else that you would like to say or you would like to create the awareness within the society?
I think the first thing that we like to send the message to our people is our strategic intent of our prime minister that trying to do something for the country, right? And the issue is that how can we continue it, right? But to continue it, someone always asks me about what will be happen if the new government reject or don't pursue or don't continue what this government do. I think don't worry about that. Because what we're trying to do, for example, we use the state of the people, mm-hmm. we use Pacharat, right? The state of the people is mean that it's not just initiate and do by the government, but it's a kind of social and economic collaboration among three parties, public, private, and people. So this will make if it's the right thing to do, it will prolong in the near future. The same for the process that we're trying to, that we just said, right? About the national reform, about national strategy, about national reconciliation. We bring people from every walk of life to engage in it. So if they take, it means what? It means the owner in the near future is not the government. Mm-hmm. The owner is them, the people itself, because they know that, okay, they have to do it. They have to involve because the benefit will come back to them, right? This is the most important thing that we're trying to do. I think this is the right way to do and the right direction. So I think that this government already do the right thing, but this year is very critical for us. Because we have a very short period of time, but as I just said, we don't want to do everything completely before we send it to submit to the new government. But we just do the right thing and just setting up the right foundation for our country, so that the new government after the election can do it or continue to do it.
Of course, these efforts of the government is not just for the government, but in fact it is for the people and for Thailand as a whole.
Yes.
Well, thank you very much for joining us. It is a very useful time. Of course, it is a great time that we have you to share all of this important information to all of us. Well, thank you so much.
Thank you.
As the minister has said, reconciliation is about process and about many fundamentals of our society, social injustice, transparency, and civility. To move toward a new era of stability and prosperity, Thailand must develop a mechanism that safeguards peacefulness in our community through cooperation and dialogue. Many of us know the term, let us agree to disagree, but be civil about it. And how important that is to ensure that our common humanity rather than our differences shape our future. The task in front of the Committee for Reform, Strategy and Reconciliation may seem daunting, but as we have heard today from Minister, the government will do what it takes for Thailand to maintain its positive momentum toward reform and realize the roadmap. We do this because it is hard, it is difficult, and the nation's biggest challenge. Thank you for watching The Insider, and please stay tuned for the next episode. Sawasdee krab.